Makranji has actually bailed me out by a very beautiful idea of the literal truth and the poetic truth, and how we make distinctions and what are the various categories. And last week we were struggling with this at the Times of India when the moon landing happened. We had the literal truth of the Americans going to the moon, and then my fellow editors gave me an SOS and said, would you have a poetic take on this or a cultural take on this? And to their great surprise, I said yes. They said, we'll give you 4 days. I said, I'll give it to you in half an hour, because that story was with me. And this is not made up. This is the poetic truth of a literal event that happened 50 years ago. When Neil Armstrong landed on the moon, a great musician called Pandit Dinkar Kaikini composed a beautiful poem in the Raga Bhairav to celebrate this. Ayo hai jeet ke manav chandra lok, chakit bhayo vishwa brahmand saro, dhan dhan prithvi jan jin racho hai yaan, aur dhan Neil Armstrong shashi raj layo hai. Now, do we rate one truth lesser than the other? This is a confusion sometimes we get when it is my way or your highway kind of thinking. It is my contention that when you have this beautiful samanvay, as you have here, of dharma and dhamma, this is a way to harmonize things. And something similar happened when the invitation came for a presentation of this nature. What do I talk to a learned audience like you about Sat-Chit-Ananda? Do I talk about the literal truth, the semantic truth, the semiotic truth, or the personal, deeply felt, reverential truth that I'm going to summon from my childhood? Again, a musician is involved. This is also a great musician who studied in Varanasi, and his pen name, the mudra, was Sat-Chit-Ananda, because his name was Chidanand Nagarkar, who was also the first founding principal of the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan's music college, which was established by Dr. K. M. Munshi. So I asked him as a child, what does Sat-Chit-Ananda mean? And I got a very serious and a very sober and a lucid response. And because I don't want to deviate from what he said, Sat was the truth of being. And I am trying to recall his words as faithfully as I can. Chit was the mind or the knowledge of that truth. And Ananda was the state of bliss or pure joy that arose from knowing that state of our being, which is a marvel beyond words. Then what he did was, he took me to the mirror. I must have been about 7 years old or something. And he says, look into the mirror. What do you see? You are alive. You are aware. Isn't that the greatest marvel? And isn't that giving you a sense of joy? This is something that I was moved by when I heard Ram Madhavji's dispensation about, you know, celebration of being. That, you know, to live it, to live that joy. He says that this is the joy of life. So many, many years ago, when I got this idea of Sat-Chit-Ananda as the joy of being, of living, I realized that there is also the category of experiences that cannot be reduced to words easily. Because there is an experiential reality which is, you know, which is beyond words. And this is one of those categories which you feel, but you may not necessarily have the words for it. Now, about the genius of ideas, the genius of this land, I also want to share a small personal memory. Years ago, when I gave up my white collar or tight collar job as a banker and a lawyer and became a journalist, giving up nearly 90% of my salary, I must confess, I was rotated around the Times of India as a trainee. And then I landed in the venerable clutches of Sardar Kushwant Singh, who was my first boss. So we got together an adventure called The India You Do Not Know. So this the idea was to challenge your own prejudices and knowledge. Go out and try to see what you do not know. And we were asked to choose states. I chose Bihar. And some of my friends made fun of me, saying that, why did you choose Bihar? Why didn't you choose Goa? I said, that is my place of origin. Why didn't you choose Kashmir? I said, that is the place of my original origin, because that's where we come from. Then why Bihar? I said, Bihar is the land which has given us the greatest knowledge in the world. You know, it has given us Mahavir Swami, it has given us Sher Shah Suri, it has given us the Grand Trunk Road's lineaments, it has given us, of course, the impeccable Bodhi. And what more do you want? And I came here, and of course I could not go to Rajgir at that time. And this was probably 45 years ago. I had this wish in my mind, because I came to Patna, I was, you know, waylaid, I went to Palamu and all kinds of places, but not Rajgir. And I was sort of keeping this thought alive in my mind, saying that before I become air and elements like Bhartrharis, will I get a chance here? And there it is. This is an opportunity that I get. And on a theme that is so wonderful, in a conflict-ridden world, I think a place like India has great relevance. And I don't speak as a politician or a writer or a journalist or a mischief maker, as sometimes they are equated. But I feel, because this is a country of deep knowledge, and I will only conclude with a small little anecdote. We talked about the genius of India, we talked about the wonderfulness of Ramji's slogan about living life. I was asked in an American setting where I was also working, how do you rate cultures? How do you rate civilizations? What do you think is the defining characteristic of your culture? And of course, you have to speak extempore at the New York Institute of Education. So I said, I'm going to steal from the Mahabharata. There is a beautiful episode of the Yaksha Prashna, where Yudhishthira is asked by Dharma in disguise, the patron deity of our conference, what is the greatest wonder in the world? So I posed this question to my fellow people. There were people from Korea, there were people from China. We were all part of a brood of journalists being groomed by the great Washington Post. We had all to work. There were no lectures. We had to just work and compete with the Yankees. Everybody came up with their bhautik sort of definitions. Then I said, this is the speciality of my land. Ahani ani bhutani gacchanti yamalayam. Shesham stavaram nityam kim ascharyam ataparam. You know, I said, this is the only culture which is able to give you an answer which is irrefutable. It says, every day so many people die and go to the house of Yama, Yama Dharma. But those that remain con themselves with this fond hope that they will never go from here. What can be a greater wonder than that? Now, this denial of death, of course, was later developed by an American scholar. It won a Pulitzer Prize, and he says that this is the defining characteristic of humanity, because it is the humans that know for sure that they're going to die, yet they are able to live. And maybe that is the subject of another Sangoshti of yours, which will talk about Eros versus Thanatos. And what I would like to leave with this particular conference is that the reason I wanted to come to Rajgir was to go to the place where the great truth was uttered for the first time, where the master says, form is emptiness and emptiness is form. You know, again, that is another era, this is another encyclopedia of learning which this beautiful culture of ours can offer to this troubled world in so many different ways. There are, and I as a brand consultant or a pen pusher or whatever for a media gorilla, I can think of zillions of ways in which this beautiful gathering of minds and hearts can benefit the world. With that, I take your leave. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks so much.